Hello, this is Yanis again, and in this lecture we are going to work on mesh networking, and in fact we are going to work on this topic for the next couple of lectures. So until now, the focus of our work was essentially on the right part of this architecture. So we looked into cloud technologies. You used different cloud technologies as part of your individual assignments, and you essentially used different kind of sensors that are in some way directly connected to the internet, In some cases, it was your computer as a virtual sensor. It was a wireless device connected over a Wi-Fi network. And in this way, data were transmitted directly to the cloud via MQTT or using HTTP push or using different other technologies. This was completely essentially the left side, the wireless sensor network was quite flat, and then we also looked into the case where we have a more detailed different layers. So essentially it's not just the sensors in the cloud, but we have also intermediate layers where essentially we can process the data, we can carry out specific data analytics tasks, we can involve decentralized databases, blockchains, and smart contracts. And of course, we also looked into the very important issue of preserving the privacy of the data. In some cases, we also examined with Andrea the possibility where you have a smartphone that is essentially on the role of a sensor. And you also did some hands-on examples with Marco on the IoT lab, how you can use testbed facilities in order to try out different technologies. You also looked into the LoRa networks for long-range wireless networking. So here we can say that we had a kind of a vertical approach where the internet essentially is extended by these things networks, and now it becomes a kind of a network of networks. So we have different devices that are connected at the edge of the network or even beyond the ends of the network, for example using a LoRa network. And in this sense, they are horizontally integrated. on the other hand side, we also have the possibility of different peripherals interconnected on a single device via USB or other ports via Bluetooth and so on. So this was also the way that you accessed sensors when you were using the IoT lab, or here essentially you are using sensors in a Raspberry Pi connected via the GPIOs, or you have the sensors of your mobile computer, of your laptop. So you see that there are different approaches on how to bring the sensors and create this kind of networks. And essentially, up till now, our approach was either on the left side, let's say we had some kind of a home network in this sense. So we were using the local relay, the our ADSL router, home router, through which our Wi-Fi, through our Wi-Fi, we were connecting with the cloud-based services. So our laptop or our Raspberry Pi was connecting via Wi-Fi directly to the internet, and it was in this sense an internet-enabled device, and either through an IPv4 address or by using an IPv6 address, data were directly transmitted to the cloud. And then we also had the opportunity with Marco to check out long-range networks, LoRa networks, where we have a star topology. We have the intermediate base stations that are acting as the centers of the star, of stars, and then the end devices connecting to these gateways, and through these gateways sending packets to the cloud. So here, of course, we have lower power. The devices, in theory, are expected to operate in kilometer range and in outdoor environments, in contrast to home environments. However, there is also this intermediate case, this nest network, where essentially we have a kind of intermediate deployment. So it could be either an indoor environment or an outdoor environment, where essentially we don't want to have low bandwidth, narrow bandwidth connectivity. We want to use a broader connection, a broadband, not so narrow connection, let's say, while at the same time the transmission range is not so small. So we want to cover a bigger area. So it could be a building bigger than a simple small house, let's say, or it could be a really big house where, of course, a single router does not reach all the different places in the house, all the different rooms. So here, for example, we have technologies like Zigbee, like Z-Wave. Even now, Bluetooth is providing mesh networking technologies. And we can have, in this way, devices connecting to another device, forming, in this sense, a hop, a multi-hop network. And then after a couple of hops of maybe a bit more, they eventually reach the gateway device that then relays their traffic to the internet. So this is where we are going to focus today. And this is essentially the type of networks that we are going to look into for the next couple of lectures. So here, this is a generic mesh network topology. You see that we have different nodes that interact with each other, essentially based on the proximity, the distance from one node to the other. So there are some roles in this network. We have the gateways. These are devices that have access to multiple network interfaces. So it could be, for example, Wi-Fi and Zigbee, our Philips Hue device that controls all the Philips lamps and sensors. And it could have an Ethernet and a Zigbee wireless network interface, or it could have different kinds of combinations. So it could be, for example, also a Z-Wave and LoRaWAN. There is no real restrictions here. Then we also have the normal nodes, that comprise that make up this this network, this wireless network. And here they could either act as a repeater, forwarding messages between the other nodes of the network, or they could be endpoints in the sense that they don't route messages for other devices in the network. And of course, as you realize, this is a really, really broad. These three rules essentially allow us to create many different kinds of networks. So we could have networks where we have more than one gateways, either for redundancy reasons or because they are providing connections to different networks. One could be LoRa and the other one could be Wi-Fi. Or we could have more powerful devices that are possibly connected to the main power supply, playing the role of a repeater, while battery-operated nodes are just endpoints, and they are not participating in this facilitation of message exchange and communication. So, in the idea here is that mesh networks do not rely on existing pre-deployed infrastructure. So, we are just connecting, positioning these devices within the area that we want to monitor, and then they create this multi-hop network. Another very important concept is the need of a centralized administration. Like, for example, in LoRa networks, we have the main, for example, Things Network website where we register our gateways, we register our applications, and then we have the declaration of the keys, the provisioning of the private and the public keys, and so on and so forth. So here, in many cases, we might not have a kind of a central administration. It could be completely, let's say, decentralized. Of course, we are using wireless communication channels. This is the idea, and as we said, we need to assume that some nodes will play this role, will act as repeaters, so they will allow communication to pass through the intermediate nodes. Now, you might have also heard the term ad hoc networking from the Latin word, in the sense that we want to have something instant, something temporary, deployed on purpose, for a specific purpose. It might be something short-lived, like, for example, a kind of event that takes place and we want to install additional devices to monitor, provide kind of acoustic support, camera support for the event, and maybe also safety monitoring for the event. We deploy the devices, they set up this wireless mesh network, and then, of course, after the event concludes, after a few hours or maybe a few days, we remove these devices and the network terminates. So it could be something quick, it could be some laptops creating a small network to exchange data, to play a game possibly, to work together, and then after this is done, the network is completed. So it is possible that this is a short-lived network, but that's not necessary. It could be, as we said, a network that we deploy in our home, because we acquired some smart devices, or it could be within a factory where we are deploying our devices, and of course we want to use wireless networks in order to reduce the number of cables that go around. So it's not absolutely the case that they have to be short-lived. These are just concepts. Of course, again, the positioning of the nodes might be fixed, like in the case of wireless network deployed in a factory. But that's maybe not the case, in the sense that we could move and change the position of a machine. We can change the position of a bulb in a house. We can move a wireless speaker to another room. So there is here this idea of dynamicity. So a device, maybe it's not continuously mobile. It could also be mobile, but it could also be essentially changing location occasionally. Or even periodically. It really, again, it's a very broad kind of type of network. And then, as we just said, nodes might also be mobile. And here we distinguish between two main categories. So we have the so-called passive mobility, where the nodes by themselves are essentially agnostic to whether they are moving, where they are located, okay, unless of course they have some kind of a localization system. The only thing that they realize is that from time to time they change position, but they have no control over this. So like our smartphone or sensors within a car. So they are moving around and then they are in this way changing. We have a dynamic topology of this mesh network. On the other hand side, again looking into these nodes, for example a smartphone attached to some headsets or maybe to our smartwatch, then maybe here there are some devices that are connected in a long-lived network, while there are some other connections that go up and down because this personal network moves around the house. But the main idea here is that the nodes do not have any control on the motion, and they might not have any kind of, let's say, they cannot even predict their mobility patterns. They don't even know their mobility schedule. While on the other hand side, there is another category of mobile nodes, the so-called active mobility nodes, where these nodes are essentially in control of their motion. So here we could have robots, here we could have, of course, drones. So here, consider that one node could essentially move towards a specific part of the network in order to improve network connectivity, or move towards another part of the network in order to extend the connectivity of the network and provide coverage to an area which was previously not covered. And we will look in more details within such kind of networks a few lectures later. So you see, there are essentially different ideas here, and when we are talking about mesh networks, we are covering a very, very broad range of network types. There are today mesh networks based on Wi-Fi technology, 802.11, that cover cities, and of course they allow to exchange data without going through the internet as an alternative, let's say, metropolitan area network. And there is as a matter of fact, the so-called Freedom Box project initiated by Eben Moglen that tries to introduce a completely decentralized internet, which is also fair and does not have all these privacy issues that contemporary internet is facing. So in this mesh network, if we look into the technical characteristics, it is reasonable to expect that there are many variations. For example, in a completely theoretical study, we might assume, like, for example, what we are going to do today in the next couple of lectures, we might assume a fully symmetric environment. What does this mean? It means that all nodes have identical capabilities and they have identical responsibilities. While, of course, it is reasonable also to assume that this is not always the case. As a matter of fact, when we deploy to real-world environments, in the majority of the cases, we end up with asymmetric scenarios where, like transmission range, for example, completely differs from node to node. And even if the devices have exactly the same network capabilities, they have exactly the same battery power, let's say. They have exactly the same antenna. Only just by considering the environment, the surrounding environment, this provides a completely different network connectivity, a completely different wireless channel, quality. Have experienced this many times in the past. We just change the location of our laptop and then suddenly the signal quality deteriorates, or we move slightly closer, just 50 centimeters closer to one part of the room, and then the connectivity improves. Or we might discover that opening a door, especially doors that are really, let's say, fire resistant and safety, they have a specific safety rating, they affect the wireless transmission. Or maybe because one node has a lower battery, then wireless transmission differs. So it is reasonable to expect that the different wireless transmissions are not essentially having the same parameters, transmission parameters. Then of course we have different batteries, different nodes may have different, even different batteries. Battery capacities in that sense. Some of them might be connected to the power supplies, some other nodes might be reducing the frequency of their processor in order to save save energy. Some other devices might have access to multi-core and maybe also heterogeneous processors. So you see there is a lot of variation here. As we said earlier, some nodes might be fixed, some other might be mobile, some are really fast moving, attached to buses, some others are attached to bikes. So we also have different speeds, different patterns of movements, and so on and so forth. And the same goes also with responsibilities. Again, in this lecture, we assume that nodes have the same responsibilities, but this might not be the case. Some nodes might be essentially dedicated repeaters, also for the purposes of security. Some other nodes might also have an elevated role. They are acting some kind of leaders of nearby nodes. We have a kind of a hierarchical structure where we have different nodes organizing local so-called clusters. And of course we might have nodes with multiple network interfaces acting as gateways, and of course this list goes on depending on the scenario. So again, this contributes to the different kinds of mesh networks that that exist, and again, it really we can continue this discussion whether they coexist, for example, with an infrastructure-based network. So we might have a mesh network that also has some kind of connectivity to an LP1, where we use the LP1 in order to transmit periodically some kind of short messages. So consider, for example, a wearable device, some kind of medical grade wearable device. So we have a kind of a jacket which is monitoring our heart rate, or it could monitor different aspects of the heart operation using also some ultrasounds, and then in case that there is an anomaly spotted, we are using the, let's say, the LoRa power network to transmit a long distance message to our doctor, or we could use a 3G network to transmit an alert to a nearby hospital. And then when essentially we are in close distance, through a kind of a Bluetooth network, we can transmit a very, very detailed collection of data, let's say a high definition trace of the operation of the heart, where essentially this this arrhythmia, this anomaly was detected. So here again, this is a reasonable scenario. There are products in the market that are following this approach in order to provide a broader kind of connectivity. And clearly here we have different traffic characteristics that differ. We have different bit rates, we have different reliability requirements. An alert, for example, through a LoRa network might not be the best way to do, since some LoRa networks are not designed, are not deployed for reliability, while a 3G network might be more appropriate. And of course, there are again many different variations. So, having said this, here the question that we are going to look into today is how we can start from a very, very basic problem, and how we can essentially use these nearby devices in order to solve the most basic communication problem. So we have all these devices that are, let's say, all of them willing to support communication, and they are willing to use their own resources in order to relay packets for other nodes. And in this case, we also assume that they are also trustworthy. So for now, let's not look into the case where we have malicious nodes, although of course this is very important, and we will look into the security issues and of course the privacy issues. So if I am using a nearby mobile phone or a nearby device in order to send my packets, and then through that device, which is owned by another individual, have my packets arrive to the internet, of course there are serious privacy concerns here. But let's say that for now, in this lecture, this is not an issue. So we have a network comprised of trustworthy devices. Some of them, as we said, have different characteristics. That's fine. But at the end, the question is how we can use this network in order, despite of all these variations, in order to solve this very, very basic communication problem. And essentially the problem is formulated as follows. Let's assume that there is a node in our network, somewhere in our network, there is this source node, which we signify with the letter S. And then this source node wants to transmit one message, just one packet, to a destination node D. So it is, let's say, a sensor reading, or it is an alert, as we were discussing earlier. So I am within my taxi, I'm having a taxi ride to my office, and then my medical grade wearable device spots an anomaly, an alert, and this message needs to reach a specific destination node, for example, the hospital. So the question here is, how can S send a data packet P to D? And of course, this is a kind of a coordination problem. How can the network coordinate, how the nodes can coordinate by themselves in order to for this packet to arrive to message D. D. So this is a very simple question, right? So you are in your home, and then you want to reach a person which is on the neighboring house. How are you going to send them a simple hello? So in this very, very simple basic version, let's assume that we have a completely symmetric environment. And let's assume that the nodes are static. Let's not go into the possibility where we have a mobile node. Let's also assume that nodes act as repeaters. So if, for example, a family member is in the next room, then we can shout hello, they will hear us, and then they will also shout hello, and this hello will probably reach our neighbor, our fellow neighbor in the next house. Let's assume that nodes have unique IDs, and then let's also assume that we don't have interference. So when I'm shouting hello, there's no one playing real loud music, or there is no one nearby honking with their car. Of course, in the center of Rome, this is not very reasonable, but okay, let's assume this. And of course, there are no node failures. So for example, when we shout hello, the person that listens this message will not go to sleep, or will not forget our message. So this is a very, very basic scenario. And still, the way to solve this is not so evident. Now, a very simple solution here is the solution of flooding. So here, what the source node is doing is essentially broadcasting, is shouting these data packets to all neighboring nodes. So assume that we are in our scenario. We could also be in the department. So someone is within lecture room A3. This is where the source node S is located. And let's say that if we shout, then our someone that is either on the corridor or on one of the neighboring rooms, for example, in A2 or in A4, will hear us. And then, essentially, they will repeat this. They will essentially broadcast by themselves this message, this hello that we have shouted. And in this way, now the people that are in room A2 will shout again, and this message will potentially arrive at A1. And on the other hand side, someone on room A4 will shout, and maybe this Now hello will arrive to someone that is in room A5 will listen to it. And then maybe someone in the corridor will also shout, and then people in the courtyard, they will also listen to the message. So you see now, essentially, some intermediate nodes are helping us to deliver our packet to the destination. And here, one important characteristic is that we have no idea where our destination node D is located. So when we start shouting, hello, please say hello to Andrea, I have no idea where Andrea is located. So maybe Andrea is located right next door in A2, or maybe Andrea is located in A7. But by just following this very, very simple solution, essentially, and of course, by assuming that nearby nodes are willing to forward my hello to Andrea, then this message will eventually reach him. So this is the most basic approach, right? So what is the format of our message? Of course, we have the destination node. So this is a message for Andrea. We might also include the source node. So this is from Yannis to Andrea. Of course, we need the payload, hello. Please tell to Andrea from Yannis, hello. And then we might also attach a kind of a sequence number. And we will see shortly why this is important, to avoid the possibility of forwarding the same packet again and again and again. So consider the case where, again, I am located in A3, I shout, please tell to Andrea that I am in A3, and then the nodes that are next to me, those in A4, those in A2, in the corridor, they repeat this. And now, when the node in the corridor shouts, Yannis is telling to Andrea that he is in room A3, this is our packet. Of course, this message, it is possible that the nodes in A4 and the nodes in A2, they will receive it again. Not from me, but from the people that are in the corridor. So you see that now they might retransmit the same message again and again and again. So by including here a sequence number and saying that this is packet number one, they can, in some sense, identify uniquely the specific message, and then they can understand easily whether they have already forwarded the specific packet or not. So this is, again, the simplest approach of all. It's the so-called flooding approach. It's the most basic solution that we can use. It does not assume any kind of a priori knowledge on the network topology or on the location of the nodes within the network topology. And of course, if the two nodes are essentially within the same network, it succeeds in delivering the message, of course, under, again, the assumption that we don't have transmissions and we don't have failures. Let's have a more specific example with a visualization that will help us. So let's assume that this is these are the nodes in the network. So you see here we have the nodes with a unique letter as an ID, and then we use these straight black lines to essentially introduce a kind of a link, but there is no such a thing as a link. Let's be here clear. This is a kind of a simplification. In fact, here there is a wireless channel. So when E wants to transmit something, It's using the wireless channel, and sometimes the transmissions of E will reach us, but this is not constant. Sometimes we might have noise, a nearby node might transmit, and we might have interference. So this is not a link like a wired cable, where it is essentially something stable. And that's why we are using here the quotes. It is just a theoretical notion, and when you are using real devices, this is not always the case. And maybe you have already experienced some disconnections with with LoRa networks. Maybe in this section that we work with, and we will do some hands-on with the mesh networks, you will also experience this. So links are not essentially like Ethernet connections, like cables that we use in fixed networks. However, for simplicity and just for the sake of the example, let's now assume that this is somehow stable, at least for the duration of this message transmission. And then the blue nodes are the nodes, initially only the source node S, the sending node, that have received the packet. So now in this network, S wants to send a message for this destination D, and as you can see here, they don't have a direct wireless link. That means that S and D are outside their wireless transmission range, or there is a lot of interference here. There are maybe some physical objects, and they do not allow a direct connection between the two nodes. If S transmits, D will not receive this message. So they have to rely on these intermediate nodes. And we also see here that there are also some other nodes, node Y, node Z, that they are not reachable by S or by the networks, the nodes of this network. So we say that there is a partition in this network, or we say that if we use a graph theory point of view, we say that our network has two components. This is one component, and this is the other component, and each component, of course, is connected. So here, in this case, we can have all nodes, essentially, we can identify a kind of a path connecting all pairs of nodes. I will not go into a kind of I will not repeat basic notions of game theory, of graph theory. Sorry, I assume that you have done them. If not, then maybe it's a good idea to go and do a quick reminder about paths, lengths of paths, shortest paths, and so on. So, S wants to send a message to D, and as we said, the first thing that S does is broadcasts this data packet, and this broadcast will reach all neighboring nodes. So in this assumption, we see that essentially we get the red lines to represent nodes that receive this wireless broadcast transmission. So, essentially, the first broadcast will be received by node B, C, and E. Now, as we said, these nodes are willing to help S, and they are willing to transmit this message, relay this message in the network. So, immediately after this receiving this message, B, C, and D, each one individually and completely uncoordinated in a completely decentralized manner, they will also broadcast the same message. Now, you see that this now moves on to A, to node H, to node G, to node F. But clearly, this message will also go back to S, and then of course the broadcast of E will be overhead by C, and also that one by C will be overheard by E. So here we have the use of these sequence numbers in order to understand that C and D are now receiving the same message that they have already received by S. And in this way, the message will gradually move through the network. That's why we have this idea now that there is a kind of a liquid. We have a bucket with water and we throw it, and this water is now going from the initial part towards the periphery of the area, and such as, let's say, a wave eventually goes and reaches the final destination. Of course, here D, as soon as it receives the message, it realizes that this is a message for him, and it will not continue this broadcast. Of course, this is not the case for M. Node M will continue, and since she doesn't know where actually D is located, as a matter of fact, as we said, nodes might not even know the topology of the network, and eventually also L will transmit, and then this concludes the delivery of the data. And in this example, we've seen how the message from S eventually arrived to D. So this is the most simple protocol, and of course here we understand that, and as we saw also, almost all the nodes of the network have been flooded, as we say, with this single network packet. So just because one node wanted to transmit this message to a specific destination, all the network, the complete network, participated in this single message exchange. So of course we understand that this is not very efficient, in the sense that all the network is involved in the transmission of just one message. And if we want to transmit multiple messages, then clearly we have to repeat this process again and again and again. Now, as we saw here, the use of the sequence numbers creates this kind of a wave, wave-like flow, from the source, which let's say could be viewed as the center of this broadcast, towards the periphery of the network. And there are many researchers that essentially view this flooding also as a kind of epidemic. So every time we broadcast a message, in some sense we are infecting the nearby node with our message. And then the infected node will infect the other nodes that are in vicinity, and so on and so forth. So we will look into this in more details a few lectures later. This is also a theoretical model to try to understand the transmission speed and how fast this flooding process is. Now, on the other hand side, we cannot give any guarantees that the packet will eventually arrive, in the sense that if the node, the destination node, is not reachable from S, then the packet will not be eventually delivered. So here we also don't have any guarantee And since we don't know the topology of the network, we don't have any assumption on the topology of the network, then maybe we don't know whether the packet has reached, or because the network, let's say, is too big, or the destination was never in the building. Like, for example, address not in the building, so no matter how many people are involved in this flooding process, he will never receive this message. So of course, it is a very, very simple process. As we have seen, we don't need to know, we don't need to learn anything about the topology of the network. In theory, it could have high reliability, in the sense that packets may be delivered to the destination following multiple paths. So, if, for example, in the previous case C fails, then the packet might be delivered from another path, so let's say from H or from E, and then the same goes with F. If F fails or if J fails, then we have multiple paths that are exploited in order to deliver the message to D. So here we have a high, let's say, reliability. And of course, when transmission rate is low, so when we don't have a really, really high rate, we are just exchanging very, very few packets, then of course it works. However, if we consider the case where everyone wants to share a message with everybody else, clearly the network becomes congested very fast. So we have a very, very high overhead, too many nodes essentially receive the packets, which maybe are not needed. And of course, it's potentially also a low reliability data delivery, in the sense that when we have multiple nodes transmitting, let's say, concurrently, we have the so-called exposed terminal problem. And this is because, again, we have to keep in mind that these wireless links are not links. These are channels, wireless channels. And when two nodes are transmitting almost concurrently or with a really short time distance, then there is interference. This so-called co-channel interference that might lead to packet transmission failures. So when in this example S1 is transmitting a message which is, let's say, for receiving node 1, this message might also reach S2. So here the transmission of S2 versus R2 might be essentially lost due to this interference from S1, or vice versa, of course, when R1 is transmitting to S1 and R2 wants to transmit to S2, we might have weird scenarios. So here there are some mechanisms like ready to send, some RTS, CTS mechanism that might help to solve this problem. However, here now we need to make extra assumptions, like nodes are synchronized, like packet sizes are fixed, like data rates are the same for both transmitting nodes, and of course then again we might not have a completely let's say working solution. We might still have cases where the environment is not so let's say the problem is not completely solved. Okay, so here one approach to address these problems and make the process of exchanging messages in a mesh network more efficiently is to somehow try to discover the network topology. And by discovering the network topology, essentially be in a position to identify routes between the source and the destination node. Now, of course, it is in an ideal case, it would be nice to also find optimal routes. However, it's not. Let's not go into this direction because, of course, we need to understand, define what is an optimal route. But let's start by just saying that instead of flooding the complete network so that the message from S reaches D, try to discover and find a route, let's say from S to C to G to K to D, or maybe to S to B to H I G K D or something like that. I mean, there are many routes in this network. Of course, you can find many more. So if we could somehow start from S and cooperate, all the nodes cooperate in order to understand more or less what is the topology of this network. It's not necessary to know the exact position of the nodes. Then we might be able to identify routes, and then instead of involving all the nodes, just transmit through the nodes that are part of this route. So here, essentially, the idea is to use a flooding. Of course, we need flooding, as we saw, in order to reach all the nodes of the network. This is a good property when we want to discover the network. Collect this information, understand certain aspects, and then essentially use this knowledge to identify routes, and then these routes will be used to send the data. So we now introduce the notion of some special packets, which are the so-called control packets. So these are, in theory, small packets. They are easily recognized by the nodes, so we can give some additional priorities, so in some sense make them reliable. And of course, we don't need to do that very frequent. So once a while, depending, of course, on certain aspects, like how often nodes change their location, how often nodes go into sleep mode, or new nodes are introduced in our network. So we can control how often we are gonna use this discovery phase, this network discovery, how often we are gonna flood the network with these control packets so that nodes can discover the topology, and then essentially keep internal records of the nearby nodes, and in this sense construct the topology of the network. Now, as soon as this is complete, then the data packets are transmitted through the discovered routes without using flooding. So now, this process of involving all the nodes of the network, of course, is limited only to the control packets. And this cost, of course, is amortized over the data packets transmissions in the network. So if we want to transmit a large number of data packets compared to this control messages, of course, the cost is amortized. If, on the other hand side, our network is only for emergency situations and we just want to send short messages, then of course this concept does not make sense. So here we are talking now of a different kind of problem. One problem is the network discovery, and the other problem is the so-called unicast routing problem. So now we have the problem of forwarding packets from a single source to a single destination, the so-called source destination pairs, the SD pairs. And it's called unicast routing because it is from a single source to a single destination. There are other variants like multicast and Anycast and so on and so forth. So here we have the Unicast routing protocol. Is a network protocol that guides packets through discovered paths. And we have two main functionalities. The first functionality is to discover the network, and based on the discovery, to select the route, a route for a given source destination pair, and also to deliver the message to their destination. Now, as you understand, routing can be complex. Now we are essentially in a situation where we have a combination of different algorithms. We just named three: the network discovery, the route selection, and the message delivery. As we understand, it requires the coordination of the nodes. It's not like the flooding where we had a simple sequence number. And of course, here it is important to take into account failures at the level of the wireless medium, but also at the level of node failures. We also want to avoid network congestion. So if there are nodes that have, let's say, kind of a central position in the node, then it is reasonable to expect that if we don't take special care, many messages will pass through them, and this will create congestions. And of course, we should be able to identify potential security breaches, because some node, for example, is acting as a black hole or a gray hole. There are many different kind of issues that might affect the security, let's say, of the network. So here we have, as we said, a collection of algorithms. These algorithms work more or less independently, but they support each other. And then, of course, the selection of routes affects network performance, and there are different performance measures that we can use, like throughput, for example, as a quantity of service in measuring the number of packets arriving over a total number of packets, or as an average packet delay, as a quality of service, measuring essentially the latency. But when we go into sensor networks, wireless sensor networks, there are also additional performance measures like energy efficiency, like the reliability, or also security. So here you see what is considered to be the optimal route is really difficult to identify very, very clearly in all cases. It really depends on the scenario. So for this reason, we also have many routing protocols, also because, as we've seen, we have different kinds of mesh networks. We discussed all these variations earlier without essentially trying to exhaust all possibilities. So in the literature, we have thousands, literally thousands of protocols that specialized. They follow a centralized versus a distributed routing decision approach. So here, for example, a simple example is the case where the source node decides the entire path, or, for example, intermediate repeater nodes are also involved in this decision, and we will see two characteristic examples today. We have other possibilities where we have stateless routing decisions. So for each data packet, we follow a different approach, for example, to achieve better security, better reliability, or we might use the so-called virtual circuits, where we follow the same path for its SD pair. We might have static versus adaptive routing decisions in the case that the traffic conditions change, or maybe because we have errors, some nodes are failing, or some wireless channels are experiencing interference, noise, and in that sense it is some routes become invalid. We also have a differentiation between the so-called proactive versus the reactive routing decisions. So we are trying to identify routes for some predefined set of source destination pairs, or instead of doing that, we just set up, we try to discover routes only if needed. So clearly, in that case, the on-demand, the reactive approach will introduce some delays when we want to set up a connection, just because, of course, we need to identify a route, maybe also discover some parts of the network, while in the other hand side, if we have a proactive routing decision, the path will be already available to us, which however implies that there will be some overhead, even if this path at the end might never be used. So of course, in all these kinds of VS, one versus the other, there are advantages and disadvantages, and clearly there are also hybrid protocols, because of course there are those that like vanilla and the other ones that like chocolate, but there are those that like both. And of course there are also the so-called hierarchical protocols that are trying to create a hierarchy and then use a different strategy for the nodes that are, let's say, close to each other versus the nodes that are further away in the network, or using some other kind of characteristic like the battery capacity of the nodes to create hierarchies within the network. So again, many different routing protocols exist, and today we are going to start by a very, very typical protocol introduced by Johnson, the dynamic source routing. Goes back to 1996. David Johnson and David Malge introduced dynamic source routing. It is a protocol implemented in almost all operating systems. It is essentially an RFC under the IETF foundation for IPv4 addresses, and it is a very, very standard, well-studied protocol. So this is a reactive protocol. When a node wants to send a packet to a node D, but does not know a route, has not identified any path up to that point, then we say that node S initiates the route discovery phase. It is stateful in the sense that as soon as a route is discovered, then all packets exchanges will go through this given source destination pair, and of course it is adaptive. We will see some mechanisms that try to restart the routing discovery when routing paths are broken. Now, each node maintains a routing table, and here the routing table essentially is comprised, it can be implemented like a dictionary, where the key of the dictionary is the destination node address, and then as a value we have an ordered list of nodes that make up the route. So it could be here an ordered list of node addresses, right? So how does route discovery works? So as we said, source node S wants to send the packet to node D. The dictionary does not contain an entry for D. So S initiates the route discovery. And this is done by using a flood mechanism, a flooding mechanism, as we saw earlier, with the control message, the so-called root request message, the RREQ message, which contains the source node address, S, the destination node address D, and then a list of nodes that make up the route. Initially, this is set just to the address of node S. Now, each time a node receives this control packet, essentially it appends its own identifier within the list of nodes, and then rebroadcasts this root request message. And in this way, this message essentially is transmitted, is flooded in the network, as we saw in the previous example. And when eventually D receives the first root request message, we say that the root request phase has reached the destination, and now the destination sends a so-called root reply control message, the RREP control message. So the root reply message is sent on a root obtained by reversing the root, which is essentially inside the root request message. So from the list of nodes that make up the root, included in the root request, essentially we reverse it, and now we have the path from D to S. And so this root reply is transmitted now not in a flooding way, but in a hop by hop way from D to S. And in this way, S is aware that D essentially has been reached, and also learns the exact path from that connects S with D. So this is how the root discovery works, and this is an example again. We have the same topology. S wants to transmit to D. It's exactly the same topology, the same wireless links, and now S starts by transmitting this root request RREQ message. So you see that here initially the list contains only S, and like before, the message is received by the neighboring nodes, by B, C, and D. Now, E will transmit this message by adding its ID in this list. So F will receive a message that contains S, E, and similarly G will receive a message from C with S, C. The same goes to H. H will receive a message with from B, which is essentially S, B, and also the same from C, and A will also receive a message with S, B. And in this way, the message continues hop by hop until eventually it reaches D. So now you see that we have messages arriving from J, which is S, E, F, J, and we also have the message arriving from the other path, so we have S, C, G, and K. Of course, now D can choose one of these paths. Let's say that now D decides to use the path that comes from node J. Of course, you see that this is a flooding process, like we discussed earlier. So it will continue from this part of the network. M and L are not aware of the location of D. Essentially, only D will stop. So now N will not participate in this process. And of course, Z and Y, since they are not in this connected component, they are in another partition of the network, they will also never receive this flooding, they will not participate in this flooding process. So now D, as we said, chooses, maybe the message from J arrived first, who knows, using some kind of a local criteria, maybe the signal strength, decides to use this path. So now the root reply is transmitted using the reverse path from that included in the control root request message. And in this way, the packet arrives to S. And in this way, S and D now know how they can communicate with each other. So now, essentially, S and also D introduce a new entry within their dictionary based on this path that has been discovered. And essentially, they also know the entire route by checking out the packet header. And that's why this is called source routing. Of course, intermediate nodes use this source route, which is included in the packet, to determine to whom a packet should be forwarded. And the data packet format more or less looks like this. So there is a packet header, which of course contains the source node, the destination node, and again, the list of the nodes, the intermediate nodes that make up the route, and then of course the payload. And here, this is how, for example, data are now forwarded from S to D, and clearly we can see that the rest of the network is not now involved. They do not participate in the transmission of the data packets. So only three intermediate nodes participate. Now, just to keep in mind that here we assume that the links, as we said, are symmetric. So E can communicate with F, and F can also communicate with E. This is the idea of symmetric links. However, this might not be always the case. So maybe the root reply cannot be sent by reversing the root request route. So if we are not in a symmetric scenario, so let's say unidirectional links are used here, then we have to repeat exactly the same discovery process for the root reply. So now the root reply is not forwarded by reversing the route. The root reply is forwarded by flooding the network. So at the end, in this way, D will be informed by S, that S wants to transmit a message to D, and then by identifying an alternative path, by flooding the root reply, S will be notified that D essentially received the original root request, and also through the root reply will also learn about the original path. And then, of course, S can notify D about the reverse path discovered. So it is a bit more complicated, but essentially it's the repetition of the first phase, and we might also end up in different paths. Okay, so what about errors? As we said, DSR introduces an adaptive mechanism. So maybe while we are transmitting a data packet following an established path, an intermediate node X fails to send a message to the next node Y. An error occurs, so maybe Y fails. Or maybe there is a lot of noise and Y no longer receives messages from X. As we said, the notion of link is not essentially, it's a theoretical notion, it does not exist in technology. So after retrying a fixed amount of times, at the end X will determine that Y is no longer available, and we'll send a root error control message to S, again following the reverse route found in the data packet. And now S, upon receiving this root error, one approach is to remove from the dictionary, from the routing table, that is, the entry for D, and then try to discover a different route. Or there are many variations here. Might try the intermediate nodes, might try to find another path and somehow fix, reuse, let's say, some parts of the previous path. So this is the example, the last hop from J to D is no longer feasible. Some kind of an obstacle has been introduced. Maybe in a wireless environment there is another device that is transmitting and it's creating, is jamming the channel, or maybe another device like a microwave oven is being activated and this creates a lot of noise in this area, in nearby neighboring frequencies, and this essentially destroys, as we say, this wireless link. So J now sends a root error signifying that from the hop from J to D is no longer available. And then, as we said, there are different approaches here to follow in order to solve the problem, or of course the most drastic one, restart from the very beginning. Another interesting notion here is the notion of a kind of optimization to speed up the root discovery. This is the so-called root caching. So the idea here is, given that the initial root request message that is used for the root discovery is done in a flooding way, we are using a flooding mechanism, we want to take advantage of this route discovery messages in order to build find essentially keep records of these routes, even though we are not interested for this specific destination node. But maybe in the future it will help us. So each node essentially, upon receiving a route request, at that point learns a path to S, and then similarly upon receiving a route reply learns a path to D. So now every node, intermediate node, has just discovered two paths. And similarly, every other node, which might not be on this path, but happens to overhear a root request or a root reply or the data packet, they also learn a path to S and D, or they also learn, if you want to move a step forward, a path to those nodes that are included in the intermediate nodes of these paths. So this is an example here. You can see that, of course, S and D are aware of their paths, but then also E has a path to D, also J has a path to S, and then F has a path to D, but also has a path to S. And then G is overhearing this root request and root reply packet, so also G now has a route to S and also potentially to D, and similarly C. So you see that this essentially builds up the so-called routing cache of the other nodes, and the idea now is that when we want to identify a new path, let's say from Z to another node, from Z to S, for example, then Z will receive an immediate root reply from the nearest node that knows this path. and it will establish the path much faster. So this is one potential extension to optimize this this flooding process and take advantage as much as possible of all this or transmission of all these control messages in the network. So to summarize, routes essentially are maintained only between the nodes who need to communicate, and in this sense reduces overhead of route maintenance, or of course we can also optimize it, as we said a bit, and reduce the route discovery overhead, and this essentially single route discovery may yield many routes to the destination due to the intermediate nodes replying from local caches, and this can help us by finding alternative paths in order to improve security, resilience, maybe also network congestion. On the other hand side, one main disadvantage of this approach is that the packet header grows with the route length due to the source routing, and this might be a problem when we start exchanging the data packets, especially when data are small due to the format of the data packet. Now, it also depends on the topology of the network. So, depending on the actual area covered by our network, it's depends on the specific case. So, if we are talking about a couple of hops, or maybe three hops, then that's okay. Now, consider your home, for example. Even if the Wi-Fi does not reach all the rooms of your house, then if you include one or at most two repeaters, then you have a clear connectivity. So it's not that the networks will have a large diameter. Usually they have a few. The diameter is usually is around 2-3, at most 4 hops. While if we are in larger network areas, for example outdoors or within a factory, or we want to have short transmission ranges in order to save energy, then like for example in Bluetooth, then or in Zigbee, then maybe the diameter is longer. Of course, again, flooding will reach all the nodes in the network, and this essentially is done only once in theory, but it's done only once for its SD pair. So if we have many-to-many a scenario where all the nodes want to communicate with each other, then this will take place many times. Of course, here we saw that this caching might help reduce this number of executions. But we also need to keep in mind that in real networks there are collisions. We have the exposed terminal problem. And of course, a way to solve it is by introducing random delays, this so-called random backoff, before forwarding a route reply or a route request in the beginning. But of course, this will introduce extra delays. And we also need to be careful when we are sending route replies based on local caches. Again, route replies are also susceptible to this exposed terminal problem. And of course, here we can introduce random delays, or we can have delays based on the node, or essentially smaller delays for those nodes that have shortest routes. But still, these are issues that we need to solve when we are in a real environment. And this is also a real interesting thing, because in paper, Flooding seems very simple, and DSR also seems, actually it is a really clever concept, but when we try to implement it and go into a real hardware scenario, then we realize that unfortunately practice is far from theory, and there is a gap that we need to cover. So that's why it's important, and we follow this in this course, to have practical experience, to have hands-on experience, and this is why it's important to use real-world testbeds where we can deploy our networks, we can deploy our protocols in real networks and see what's happening, not only in simulated environments, not only in pen and pencil scenarios. And of course, to close this discussion, this initial discussion, we need to also keep in mind that at some point CASs need to be cleared. We might have very, very old records, which of course might pollute the other CASs by as they are circulated every time there is a request. So even the idea of a CAS as a mechanism needs to be carefully designed and implemented in order to provide benefits rather than creating problems in the overall execution of the protocol. Okay, so another protocol that we are going to see today, and this is the last one for today, is the so-called Adhoc on-demand distance vector routing. The protocol again is presented in 1999, if I remember correctly. It's one of the most widely studied protocols. There are hundreds of variants for this protocol, examining all different aspects that can be examined for symmetric, asymmetric, mobile, non-mobile, secure, non-secure. We are not going to go into these details. We just want to see here how we can essentially improve the performance of DSR by decentralizing a bit the process of identifying a root path. So here, as we saw, essentially the source is declaring the path that will be followed for the packet. So all the intermediate nodes are listed in details from the source. While in our DUVU, we are following a different approach. The only thing that is specified is who is the next node, the next hop, let's say. So here the routing table is different. So for each destination, as we say, each row in the routing table contains the following information. We have the destination node address and just the next hop, nothing else. And then we also keep the destination sequence number, and this is used to determine the freshness of the entry, and the lifetime, which is also needed to understand how long this entry will remain in the routing table before it is removed. So in some sense, this solves the problem of the stale CAS entries of DSR. So here the route request is similar in the sense that when a route wants to a node wants to find a new route to a destination, again it uses the route request control message, and every time a node rebroadcasts a root request. Now, instead of appending its node address within the root request, essentially it sets up a reverse path pointing towards the source. So there is a kind of link reversal here, which is a really interesting idea, and we will look into this in more details in the next lecture. So now, a route can be determined when the route request reaches the final destination, or if an intermediate node has, let's say, a fresh enough route to the destination. That's why here we use the destination sequence number inside the route request methods to understand the last known destination sequence for this destination. Now, when essentially we identify a destination or we identify an intermediate node with a fresh route, this route is made available by now transmitting a route reply back to the source of the route request. Now, since each node receives this original, each node receiving this original route request creates a route back to the source of the request, the route reply now follows this path to reach the source node. And similarly, the intermediate nodes can also essentially take advantage of this message, of this route reply, in order to set up a path to the destination. This way, we have a variation without increasing the size of the packet in the way that it was done in the DSR. And here we need to keep in mind also that in certain technologies, like for example ZigBee networks, wireless communications technologies, impose certain maximum packet sizes. Like in ZigBee, it is 134 bytes. So there is a limit to the packet header and how big it can be. Of course, if we also have the complete addresses, like IPv4 addresses, or if we even have IPv6 addresses, which are 64 bits, you realize that we don't have too much space there. But we are not going to look into this problem now. But just keep in mind that packets in these kinds of networks, in wireless networks of low-end devices, might not be of unlimited size. So clearly, this is an important improvement from of this source routing problem. Now, similarly, we also have route error messages. Again, the nodes monitoring the status of their nearby nodes. And when they realize that, let's say, a link has been broken, or let's be more realistic, they have not heard any transmission from a nearby node for a long period of time, then they say that this node is no longer accessible, and they issue a root error message to notify the other nodes that this essentially connection has been lost and the node is no longer reachable, and in this way notify the node. So let's check an example, and we will conclude today. So again, we have the source node that wants to communicate with D. So now we have the root request message transmitted by initiating the root discovery phase. And now you see that upon receiving this message, node B, C, and D will automatically set up a path, a reverse path to S. So now the routing table of E contains one entry towards S, and similarly C and B have one entry with S as the next hop. And the same thing happens with all the other nodes of the network. And you see now that we have a kind of a directed graph created toward S. And this is a very, very interesting idea that we will exploit also, we will see in the next lectures. So when the message eventually reaches D, now we also have all the other nodes informed about this path to S. And of course the size of the routing table is much smaller, since the only thing that they keep is the next hop and not the complete path. And in this way, D transmits the message back to S. And this example concludes the presentation of the AODV protocol. I don't want to go into more details. As I said, AODV has been studying thoroughly in the past 20 years since it was first introduced. Maybe there are thousands of variants out there based on AODV, but in general there are many different routing protocols for wireless ad hoc networks, for wireless mesh networking. We will continue with this topic. We will discover some, we will examine some other interesting properties and some other, let's say, characteristic mechanisms that we can use to improve the performance of communication in such networks in the next class as well. Of course, we will have the opportunity to discuss these topics through the Google Meet channel that we have, and of course we can also use the Slack channel or Google Classroom, or in the worst case you can also send me an email if all the above fail. But I'm pretty sure that Slack will, as the preferred method, will be enough. So that's it. Thank you for listening, and we will continue this over Google Meet. Bye.